I would like to introduce you to our panelists who are going to, you know, introduce themselves more properly. But all the way on the my left, we have Signe Baumann. Woo! Okay. So just a little background about Signe. I was introduced to her by Bill Plimpton, who's obviously very entertaining, well-known animator. And he said, I know someone who's more entertaining than me. And I was like, who the fuck is more entertaining than Bill Plimpton? But as it turns out, she is quite entertaining and quite talented. And I'm very excited for her to show her work tonight. And then next to her, we have Jack Feldstein. Jack is an incredibly talented artist as well, and also just super supportive of independent film. I met him at a screening about 3 or 4 years ago. Had no idea who he was. He had no idea who I was. I mentioned that I was having a screening like 2 months later, and he was like, oh, I'll come. And I was like, there's no way this guy's going to show up. He has no idea who I was. And he did come, and he's been so supportive of my work ever since and so supportive of other independent filmmakers. So thank you, Jack, for being here. And next we have Andy London, who, from what I understand from his bio, he was approached by both Nickelodeon, right, and Disney to do animation for them, but then they saw his film A Letter to Colleen, which we're gonna see tonight, and they both quickly backed away. So you'll see why. everyone has their cell phones turned off, right? Yeah, that's right. That's right, turn off your cell phones. And then we have the very, very talented Ruth Langford, all the way from Boston. Thank you so much for coming. Ruth is actually the senior lecturer in animation at Harvard University, so she's got a lot of very interesting work to show tonight as well. Just really quick, a show of hands. When you guys heard adult animation, how many of you thought this was porn? Oh, no. That's why you guys signed on to do this. Okay. All right, well, some of it is erotic, but it's definitely not porn. So, but you guys will see. Anyway, I'd like to give each panelist an opportunity before we begin to just say a little bit more about themselves. So, Signe, do you want to start?
I don't know what to say, actually, but I really thought it was going to be porn. And I brought my napkins with me, but... But I guess I have to throw them away dry now.
Not necessarily.
Oh. Okay, will you help me?
You need the puttees.
I just to be short, I am born in Latvia. That's where my accent is from. And I was educated in Moscow. That's where I got my brain. And I live in New York. That's where I got my naughty side. And... I made 15 animated short films, and I made one feature film, Rocks in My Pockets. And towards the end of the evening, I'll be giving away 3 posters, but I just won't give them away. I'm going to quiz you on the things that are going to be discussed today, so memorize everything, okay? And you get a free poster.
Awesome. Thank you. Jack?
Yes, first of all, thank you, Heather, for organizing tonight. I think it's awesome that we're here. I'm originally from Australia, from Sydney, Australia. And what my films are nothing to do with sex. Well, they've got a little bit of sex in them, but I'm not good at sex is the trouble. So any sex in it is bad sex. But they are educational. Educational and entertaining, and that's my shtick, is to do educational and entertaining animation films. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Andy London, and I have a production company called London Squared Productions that makes no money. And I teach in the South Bronx at a school called Hostos. It's part of the CUNY system, and I'm running an emerging program there. And I like to make films. I've made quite a few with my wife. We collaborate together. We've been collaborating for about 18 years now, and most of them have to do with like really personal stuff about me. I like to talk about that kind of stuff. And anyway, that's all I have to say, really.
I'm Ruth Lingford, and I come from London, but I live in Boston because I teach at Harvard. And I, for some reason, I make feel-bad films. I don't know why. And my last film, which I'm going to show you some of, is a film about orgasm, which also manages to be a feel-bad film. I'm not quite sure how I managed that. Well, you can judge for yourself.
Thank you. So the way that this is going to go is we're going to just show short clips or short films from each animator, and they might say a few words in between, or maybe we'll just move on to the next clips and so on and so forth, and then we'll get really more into the topic after that. But I really do want to open up really quickly before we begin that with a question to the panelists, which is, why do you think animation is more of an adult's medium than a children's medium?
Well, I mean, to me, animation is able to express very complicated thoughts, very complicated ideas and concepts. And so there are these shortcuts, metaphors, symbols that children, you know, don't quite get yet. And so for me, that is the essence of why I use animation as my medium, because it is just a very... very complicated medium, you know, and it can do so much that I can't even start. And when you say animation is for children, which is like mainstream media, like makes convinces that, I get really mad and I start shaking inside me because it's so unfair. Because the, you know, the first moving images are animated. So, and that's my, I mean, Ruth, you know.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. But of course, there are some advantages in people's view of animation as being safe. I mean, it does. I think people tend to watch animation as if they're children sometimes, in a very open way, and that means they're kind of unguarded, and you can hit them harder, I think. And also, I think we have a status that's a bit like the court jester, where nobody's really takes us seriously, but. Therefore, we get a lot of freedom as well. It's a double-edged sword.
When I first started, I couldn't afford to animate, I mean, to make films, and it was such a cheap way to express myself. And what I really like about the medium was it doesn't matter what you say with it, but it's a very, it's if you have the know-how, you can really do something very, very cheaply, very effectively. And I don't care whether it's for kids or if it's for adults. My stuff tends to be for adults. Because I think it's just about expressing yourself and going where you need to go. And animation shouldn't just be about a product for children.
I believe that animation brings a level of delight to everything. And adults need delight as much as children. So that's what I believe about animation.
Well put. Yeah, I couldn't have said it better myself. But then again, I'm not an animator, so that's probably better that you guys said it. So why don't we get right into the screening portion? We're going to kick it off with one of Andy's films, which is A Letter to Colleen, followed by three very, very short films by you as well, three 30-second films.
When I was 18 years old, my birthday present was having sex with the girl of my dreams, who was a drug addict, and she somehow lured me into her friend's apartment, and there were 25 of my classmates watching me have sex. And it was a really horrific, scary night and haunted me for many years. And she called me about 6 years after it happened, collect, and she was in a trailer home and really fucked up. And I couldn't get her off the phone. And when I hung up, I wrote her a 25-page letter and smoked about 60 cigarettes. And I went to the mailbox to mail it, and I never mailed it. Instead, I brought it to a Printed Matter bookstore that was somewhere in Soho. I forgot where it was exactly. And they published it. And I sold 10 copies. And then years later, my wife discovered it and said we should make a film about that. And anyway, you can see it.
I wrote a story about you. This one is funny, sad, and it flows. And if it's as good as I think it is, you might want to have me arrested. Colleen laughed so hard she was spitting in my face. I had to wipe the black phlegm off my face, so I stuck my tongue out. She tried to bite it off. I hate you, Colleen. I love you. I'm sick of driving you to AA meetings. Besides, I don't even have a license yet. This all took place at her friend Stacy's house. It was my 18th birthday present. She was going to fuck me whether I liked it or not. Truthfully, I didn't like it. I didn't like her. I didn't like the fact there were 25 other teenagers, all they could watch. I didn't like the two 11-year-olds wearing pajamas and drinking beer, or the parents downstairs watching TV and drinking hot cocoa. I wanted her. I needed her. And my family psychologist said I ought to pick another racehorse. Colleen was bound to lose. She brought me into a bedroom that smelled of manure. Her best friend Stacy was so strung out, she didn't even know enough to do it in the bathroom. So her shit piled up beneath her dirty clothes. The parents never said anything. As a matter of fact, I don't think they ever saw her room. She pulled out a pair of horse clippers. What are you doing? Her hair falls off in clumps. It squirmed on the floor. I swear her hair follicles were screaming. She was bald. I had a deep desire to lick her hair. Suck her scalp clean. She was ivory to me. Too bad she hardly bathed. Where was this night going besides the local rehab center? What happened to the good old days, shopping at the mall and grabbing a burger before we catch the bus back home? Now it's fuck, fuck, fuck. Get drunk and rock and roll. What happens if you don't like rock and roll? What happens if you like Light FM? All right, I confess. I like The Sound of Music. It's my favorite album in the whole wide world. Suddenly, she laughed again. It was forced, but I laughed too. She punched me in the stomach and I fell over in pain. She proceeded to climb on top of me and bite my neck. I smelled a funny smell. It rolled from her lips, down the side of my face and onto my chin. Was it puke or alcohol? She ripped my shirt down the back. It was Banana Republic. My grandmother would be angry. I socked her in the head. Surprisingly, it put her in a better mood. Colleen, what are you doing to me? You feel like Barbie. I've only practiced on Ken. Man, what are you doing? Why are you licking my thing? It's not a lollipop. It's as sour as a pickle. And it's sensitive too. Colleen, wait a minute. Wait. Don't step away. I'm enjoying this. Oh, I see. You have to throw up. Her freckles sparkled under all the lighters our friends were holding up. It looked like a concert. All the big-haired headbangers began to chant. The 11-year-olds chanted too. Fuck her, fuck her, fuck her up the ass, dude. And when you're done, send her over to me. The two 11-year-old girls must have been awfully confused by this. They thought Colleen and I were brother and sister all this time. The bedroom lights went back on. The teenagers held up scorecards. Not bad for my first performance. Oh God, I have a headache. I wish I were back home, watching TV in my Superman underoos. Everyone stops cheering, and the two little girls finish wiping me off. Colleen starts to thrash. She lets out a primal scream. Her arms and legs thrash and thrash and thrash in the air at somebody who just wasn't there. It's 6 years later, and I still can't finish the story. It will continue if and when I ever stop throwing up. By the way, Colleen, who were you thrashing at that night? I know it wasn't me. Was it God? I'm sure you know. He isn't going to do anything. His specialty is only making people nuts. Love always, Andy.
Called Eager to Please. I have copies if you'd like. I wanted to do a pen name because the stories in the book are very, very, very personal, and I make fun of my sister who's mildly retarded in it. So I wanted to give her a little distance from it. And anyway, and from the book, we did a series called Made You Cringe, and they're little 10-second animated shorts, and they're really, really short because at the time I had an infant, and I didn't have more than 15 minutes at a time to work, is the truth. And so every time he would, you know, shit his pants or his diaper or throw up, I would clean it, and then he would go back to bed, I would work, and then change it all night long. And so we did about 20 of them, and this is a few of them.
Don't move. Ducky, don't do that.
All right.
That's my dog. She's a little older now.
Thank you, Andy. So we're going to move along now to a clip from Rocks in My Pockets by Signe Bauman, which it should be noted, this clip actually did not make the final film, correct?
Right,
so it's technically an outtake, but it's very well worth watching. You want to give a little background?
Do you want me to talk about the clip?
Yeah, so this is New York.
Yeah, I was working in a feature film for like 4 years, and you know how things add up, and then you have to tighten it all up, and this thing was just not sitting well. I always thought that, we human beings, we are so creative, and we would, almost anything could be used to commit suicide. I can use this mic to kill myself. And I think it's just very uniquely human, and I think it's also very funny that, we are so creative. And since as a human being, you can only kill yourself once or, twice, so you have actually limited opportunities, right? So you have to really, really think it through. You have to be very careful what you choose because you may not be able to do it again. And so for me, I decided that there is how you sometimes determine what you're gonna do by asking first what you're not gonna do. And I'm a certain kind of person, I don't like to be rude to people, I don't like to delay people, I want to be nice. And so I feel that, committing suicide is not always nice, and so I have to make it a really good way so it would inconvenience least of the people. And, sorry. So this is the episode, like 5-minute clip from the movie that obviously the editor in me didn't like because it was making a lot of people uncomfortable. Some people said it triggered their, whatever the triggers, right?
Yeah, yeah.
It's a trigger. And also because it was just not advancing the story very well. So we took it out, and you have a very rare opportunity to enjoy this now.
Yes. Now, I live in New York many years later, and I think I would know the right brand of rope if I decided to hang myself. I would know to rub the rope with a bar of soap so that the friction of the separate strands would be minimal, and the sliding of the rope through the slip knot tightening the noose would be swift and successful. I would think of stripping from the waist down, because I've read somewhere that sudden and violent strangling causes a person to piss and shit herself as the intestinal muscles go lax. I wouldn't want whoever discovered me hanging in my bedroom to have to clean the shit and piss off me. It would be hard enough on that person already seeing my dead body to clean the stinky stuff too. But then, when I think of it, if I stripped down before hanging myself, the shit and piss would be on the floor. That would be no good either. One has to be considerate to one's fellow citizens. I'd use adult diapers. I would never think of jumping off the Brooklyn Bridge. First, there is no easy access from the pedestrian path to the rail where you can actually jump. While climbing over those hurdles, the cold and wind might change my mind. Sometimes just feeling fresh air can affect the way I think, and I might want to go back. But it would be no good to go back when someone might have already discovered my suicide note, which of course would say, it's no one's fault, I just don't see a reason to continue anymore, etc., etc. It would be a shame to go back with another failure. Secondly, although the Brooklyn Bridge would give me a spectacular last view, there is a very strong chance it wouldn't be my last view, as I've heard that the Brooklyn Bridge had 24-hour surveillance cameras installed just for suicide watch. If that's true, then for the rest of my life, I'd have to pay a huge debt to New York City for the rescue squad saving me. I would never think of jumping off a high-rise building. I am afraid of heights. And although some psychology books imply that your fear denotes a strong attraction, I don't think so. Cutting my wrists with a razor blade while sitting in a hot bathtub is totally unacceptable as well. Razor blades freak me out more than heights. And I haven't taken a hot bath in the last 15 years because sitting in hot water makes me drowsy and nauseous. Besides, a view of my own blood streaming into the water I am sitting in would definitely make me faint. You might find it odd, but I want to be totally conscious till the very end to observe the expiration of my own life. Then, there are opportunities to walk in front of speeding trains, jump under moving subway cars, and walk on the red light. But I've never had an ambition to make headlines in the news as the person who stopped traffic. People are busy. They have places to go. Who am I to hinder other people's dinner plans and make them late for romantic dates? No, I see suicide as a very private business. Unless you want to make a political statement, but I am not there. Not yet. Sleeping pills. There was a slight attraction to that idea, but when I tried it once, I only got very sick and very awake. For a few weeks afterwards, I had the sensation that the cavity of my mouth was very big, while my tongue was too small to reach the palate. Speaking seemed impossible, so I stopped talking till my tongue grew back and connected with the palate again. My dosage of Dimetrol was either too little or too much. And that's exactly what I don't like about pills. You have to be a doctor or a nurse to know the right amount and the right brand. I've considered my grandmother's plan of simply walking into a body of water to see what happens. But it only works as a thought. Water in nature is always a few degrees colder than human body temperature. Cold makes you feel alive, sensing the border between your warm body and the outside frigid world somehow makes you more protective of your body. You want to make it warm and might forget about killing yourself. Excluding all the possibilities, I see only one way in front of me, that of the rope, soap, and diapers. But even that requires a lot of effort, planning, and cunning. In an ideal world, I would just close my eyes and say, out, and I'd be dead. Then, after a while, I'd say, in, and I'd come back to see who misses me. But then, this ideal world already exists. It is called sleep. If I just lie in bed still enough, eventually I am out for long enough to hear a phone ring 16 or 23 hours later. Someone is missing me already.
Very, very, very honest. I think a lot of us can relate to these thought processes. Do you want to say anything else before we move on?
What?
Do you want to say anything else about it before we move on?
Yeah, no, I see why it's out of the feature. I see why it didn't make the final cut.
Okay, so we're going to move on to a couple of short clips from Jack. Jack, we're going to show a clip from Vaudeville, Psychology Part 2, and Fantastical World. So do you want to say anything about...
So all three of them?
All three. If you want to say something about each one before each one. You want to say something about Vaudeville?
Yeah, that would be awesome. What are we seeing first?
Vaudeville.
Okay. The first one is How to Break into Yiddish Vaudeville. And as I said before, I'm into education and entertainment. And this covers the history of vaudeville, Yiddish vaudeville in New York City, which I'm fascinated in, as obviously you are. And it's self-explicatory, I think. I can't remember what I sent you, but it should be self-explicatory.
Shh. How to break into Yiddish vaudeville in three easy steps. Now, before we get into the three easy steps, we should explain a few things. First off, you may be asking, what is Yiddish? Yiddish is the language of Ashkenazic Jewry. It's about 1,000 years old. It's a Germanic language. A lot of folks say it's not a language at all, it's a dialect, but why trust a lot of people? You know the difference between a dialect and a language? An army. Now, the next question, what is vaudeville? Just as Yiddish is the voice of Eastern European Jews, vaudeville is the voice of the people, literally from voix de ville, the song of the town, or vaud de vire, song of the valley of Vire. It's unclear. Some also say it's from vauder, to go, plus vire, to turn. But that's all in French, and who speaks that anymore? The upshot is vaudeville means variety. Adagio dancers, singers, comedy teams, flash acts, tab shows, trained animals, transvestites, acrobats, convicted criminals, magicians, mesmerists, monologists, anything that might persuade folks to plunk down their quarter to see the show. Now, if you want to put dates on it, we'd say vaudeville runs from about October 24th, 1881, when Tony Pastor cleaned up the acts in his Bowery honky-tonk to make them suitable for the whole family, and it goes up to about November 16th, 1932, when the Palace Theater, the pinnacle of vaudeville, dropped its live shows and went over to a full-time movie house. But for those 50 years in between, vaudeville was American entertainment, with wheels, or circuits, covering every big city and podunk town in the country, with clean and straight and fine entertainment suitable for women and children. No mentions of Daddy Browning and Peaches. No. Family-oriented and fun for all. That's vaudeville. What is Yiddish vaudeville? Well, Yiddish vaudeville is much the same. It's just without the adagio dancers, flash acts, trained animals, acrobats, convicted criminals, magicians, or mesmerists. You see, your usual Yiddish vaudeville bill had about four or five spots. Let's say a singer, a dancer, a husband and wife comedy team, and it ended with a tab show. A tab show is a one-act operetta or a popular melodrama that's been pared down to a manageable size. Yiddish vaudeville also lasted quite a bit longer than it did on the English stage, because TV and Hollywood didn't steal all its stars and kill it. So Yiddish vaudeville kept going strong right up into the 1950s, and even today it's going gangbusters, as you can see by the line of people waiting for me outside the studio.
So that film is going around the Jewish film festivals all around the world, so where there's a big revival now of Yiddish vaudeville, thanks to the film. Shane Baker, who is narrating that, is the expert in the world on Yiddish vaudeville. He's an Episcopalian from Kansas City, and he's about... when he was 21 in the 90s, he came here and he spoke to all the old Yiddish vaudeville stars. He was obsessed. And learnt their acts. So he's the only man now alive who speaks perfect Yiddish and does Yiddish vaudeville. So that's a wonderful irony as well.
What's awesome. So we're going to show a very short clip from Psychology Part 2.
The psychology of script writing.
Yes.
My passion is script writing. And this is about the any of you script writers as well? You must be, I suppose, if you're animators. Yes.
Someone I hear a child.
A script writer. I hear a script writer. That's exactly what we sound like. So my passion is script writing, and this is just telling you a little bit about who you are when you are a script writer.
The narcissistic theory. Now, Narcissus, he was a handsome fellow who fell in love with his own reflection. Unfortunately, it ended badly. It could be said that scriptwriters, they're those people who fall in love with their own thoughts. And the process of recording those thoughts, well, that's scriptwriting. And this explains the intense anger that's often experienced by scriptwriters when their work is rejected or altered. Ooh. Yeah, if scriptwriters, they love their own ideas, then rejection of those ideas, it leads to a personal sense of feeling unloved. And let me tell you, very few things make a person more furious than their love when it's scorned. Look, the act of scriptwriting itself, well, it indicates that a person, they believe their thoughts are unique and worth noting. Look at this person here, he really thinks that. That belief of specialness, well, it's a classic narcissistic trait. Look at him. Look at this. Look at her. Ha! I mean, after all, every human being, they got many thoughts. You've got many thoughts, millions of thoughts. But only some believe that those thoughts, they're extraordinary and they possess great value as the basis of a script. Yeah, do you believe that? Yeah, I reckon you might. Look, when the world conspires to counter a scriptwriter's belief system, or when the script's it's not chosen, or it's changed vastly by a director, or even when it's not recognized to be as special as the scriptwriter, him or herself, that they believe, then cognitive dissonance in the scriptwriter creates great inner psychic pain. Okay, so what's cognitive dissonance? You know, like for instance, if you say, my script's special, yet they rejected it.
Okay. If you watch the film, then by the end of it, you'll either be able to write a script or you never want to get near a script in your whole life. You'll have that choice. But this is a little bit of a clip from it.
Like I repeated it twice, so I'm not going to write it down. You can write it down. You got a pen, find a pen, write it down. And if your script doesn't have that, if you can't sort of boil it down to a script is what a character wants and how he or she overcomes obstacles to get it, then this is what I suggest you do. You take the script like this and you throw it here into the bin, throw it, maybe even stamp on it. I'm not sure. It's not going to work. That's what a script is. This film is about me getting you to write your script and overcoming the obstacles that you're gonna come across to do that. And the obstacles basically are you. You are your own obstacle. Yep, that's it. You are your own obstacle in writing your script. That's my quest. I'm the protagonist of this particular film, and my quest is to overcome you, the obstacle in writing your script. So it's we're in a postmodern thing here.
Anyway, so I go through 32 rules of script writing, which you can then break, but you have to know the rules before you break them. That's what the film does.
Thank you, Jack. And if you haven't noticed, Jack's style is neon animation. So that's but maybe we can talk about that a little bit later also.
Yes, yes.
Awesome. So next we have two clips from a longer film called Little Deaths by Ruth Langford. Do you want to talk a little bit about it?
Yeah. Actually, Little Deaths is an 11-minute film, and it started off because I had what I thought was a really brilliant idea, which was that I would interview people and ask them to describe orgasm. And, of course, that would be impossible. So I would make my soundtrack out of all the moments when they were lost for words, all the ums and ahs. And I thought that was a really smart idea. So I got the voice recorder and I started interviewing people. But I live in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and nobody was lost for words at all. And I ended up with about 30 hours of really interesting stuff. I learned a huge amount. So this film is based on these interviews. What does orgasm feel like? And there's some questions which I asked, which I've put on screen. And you're going to watch two clips. The whole film is 11 minutes. I think you're going to see about 7 minutes of it.
Yeah, I feel like having orgasm now.
Yeah, well,
it would be very good.
You might recognize one of the voices there.
I was alone with my late partner when she died. And just at the end, actually, in that final moment, actually, that I did just think, oh, that was like, because I witnessed her having orgasms.
That's the most important thing to me, is the sort of crawl up, kind of like a roller coaster. It kind of feels like I'm climbing and at the same time falling.
And then it builds up, right? And then it builds up and you feel that this pressure is on its way.
And it gets faster and faster. And it has that, you know, that feeling when you're really high up on a swing.
And when you reach the climax of that pressure, like of the pressure getting to that very point, it's like gates are open.
I had to describe it for a woman that wasn't sure she had one. And I guess the concept I came up with is like, there's a gum that used to be popular that had like a filling in the center that was juicy. It was like Pop Rocks first, and then this hot, juicy liquid.
I would say it's like chocolate mousse.
It is intense.
heightening of like the electricity of the body, almost to the point of pain. And it starts in the pelvis, and then it extends from there like in strings.
And the standard metaphor is fireworks, but that isn't even quite right.
Could be like volcanic, I guess, would be an image.
It's like an itch, and you need to scratch it, and you scratch it, and then you scratch it, and you're satisfied, and it no longer itches.
Like a bomb, like a pleasure bomb dropped deeper in your body. And then it explodes, you know, so softly and muffled.
And it's like, have you ever done heroin?
You know when Daffy Duck disappears in like one frame and you just see the clouds? You know, if you would just see this one moment, there would be no Daffy Duck.
Shooting the gun, and when you shoot, you're all like one thing. You and the gun, but it really is just all kind of one thing. Like, psh, blank out.
I'm completely obliterated, really literally no longer there.
As a person, you are suddenly basically void.
And sometimes it's sort of like a darkness, like a redness.
A big light. And it just sort of goes to white.
Like, you know, like lemon white. Like white, like lemon yellow, but totally whited out light.
It's about light.
Snowstorm is like white noise on the TV.
Like icing. Like icing on a cake. Like the filigree icing.
Weird images in my head, which is like a certain street in Riga, for example. Like a tramway stop in Riga, some corner.
Abstract, symmetrical B shapes. Folding into themselves.
Going into the cathedral, in I think largely like the space inside. Modern Homes. That was another whole series of orgasms with this one particular guy.
I thought of broccoli.
So I just want to give a big round of applause to all the animators for all their work. So I think what I'd like to do is kind of just combine the Q&A with just kind of a little discussion. Something that Signe actually brought to my attention that I hadn't really thought of before. For those of you that know me, I'm much more inclined to watch documentaries. That's really my preferred genre. I never really thought about animation as much as I had until I met Bill and until I met Signe. And she had pointed out to me that filmmaking by no means is easy. Like, no method of filmmaking is easy. No genre is easy. But you can take a camera and go outside and shoot something. A scene does exist if you just shoot it, right? But with animation, you quite literally have to create something from nothing. You have to hand draw every single frame, you know? And so I think that's pretty spectacular. Do you guys kind of maybe want to comment on that a little bit?
Yeah, you have to be a bit crazy to be an animator, I think. I did meet a young woman once who claimed to be making an animated film using the medium of stone carving. But I never saw the film. I don't think it ever got made.
My wife has a metaphor. It's like pushing a golf ball across the country with your nose. It's a little retarded.
More people would watch that, probably.
No, but the difference is, in documentary film, like I had a friend in Latvia who is a documentary filmmaker, and she would want to hang out with me. She would like, let's go out, let's do stuff, let's go to this party, there's events. And I'm like, no, I have to go home. And she says, what's at home? And I'm like, work. And like, I'm not interested in people outside my head, you know, it's just, I have to bring the people who are in my head into outside, you know. So for her, everything that was, that she met the people, they would come into her head and into her work. And for me, it was opposite. I would just bring the people in my head into my work, and that's to existence. And like, to be honest, like, my personality does not fit animation at all, because I'm lazy, I hate to work, and I, like, I don't know what a curse it is. I end up working like 16 hours a day, and I hate it. But but then if you don't do it, then nothing will happen, you know? So it's just very frustrating.
About 15 years ago, I made a film, and it took a year and a half to make. And I took a beautiful bedroom window that was 9 feet tall and covered it in duct tape and aluminum foil for 18 months. And I made it into this pit. It was just disgusting. And I would just cry and scream. People thought I was abusing my wife. I was just beating up my dolls, my stop motion dolls, or throwing them across the room. You know, I don't quite know why I did it. It's a really great rush when you finish it, but those 17 months before, they suck. They really do.
What I say is that it's those of us who need freedom from everything. It's probably absolute freedom, which doesn't exist in the world anywhere except in animation.
Well, I mean, freedom, but it's also a form of slavery, okay?
Oh, man, this is for another Stoop series. We're going to have to come back.
Paradoxical, yeah.
Yeah, well, I think as you guys had mentioned earlier on, I think, you know, there's so many complicated concepts that as adults we have to, that we think about and that we have to deal with day to day, that it's really hard to express that in art, especially when you're dealing with live action. It's like there's only so much CG can do. But with animation, you can create these visual metaphors that express these very complicated concepts that, again, for kids, that their minds aren't quite there yet. They can't quite be that. They're still very literal. I'd also like to, do you have a question?
I do. Aside from Andy's one film about his back brace, I noticed that you all use narration, you utilize narration instead of having the characters themselves on screen sort of have their own voices, and I kind of wanted to know what, why you chose to go down that road as opposed to sort of, you know, give the characters themselves each individual voices. Mm-hmm. Is that something you do in your films all the time, or, you know, why that?
Well, I mean, you know, my film Birth had characters, and it's just from, I would blame programming. Heather chose the film.
It's true.
I mean, I have 15 short films, and, you know, they're all variety. Mm-hmm. They're like silent films, and they're like talky films, and I do like, I think that one thing of the resistance that we have, the independence we have, the resistance to that commercial mass media production is that we have very personal stories. And that is that the commercial production cannot go there because that's not what commercial is about. So that is the niche that we are forced to occupy. And if you make a film, you know, like you like kind of pretend story, you know, that's you trying to competing with Pixar. Mm-hmm. But if you make very purely personal film, that is the niche, you know, that is, and that also has more power than, let's say, if I hired Meryl Streep and she read the same words as if she was me, you know, great acting and everything, but it's still acting. Whereas when I read them, but I don't read them, I say, you know, I improvise with Steel Beat of Sex, mm-hmm. it has the truth. That is my truth, and that is the truth that I'm trying to tell. So that mm-hmm. is one of the reasons.
Yeah, it's a way to be more intimate. And it's a wonderful thing to be able to do that. It's one of my favorite things is to do a voiceover.
Yeah, I do mostly narration of people because it's a stream of consciousness for me that when people speak, it's when people tell you a story, when you see the story in your head, I see stream of consciousness type imagery. And that's kind of what I love. I'm in love with that.
So we actually are going to wrap things up pretty soon. So we'll take one or two more questions.
Whose work influences your animation style?
Good question.
Mm-hmm. I'll start. More painters. I look at painting and sculpture. The last film I showed, Pleasures of War, was. I looked at a lot of Renaissance paintings and sculptures of the Judith and Holofernes story, and a lot of those found their way into my work. In terms of animators, I'd say Yuri Norstein and Caroline Leaf maybe the biggest influences on me.
My background's painting. I love Philip Guston. I love Pollock and de Kooning. I love television. I'm a big fan of TV right now. I like Buffy the Vampire Slayer. I like The Americans. I mean, a lot of things. Those are big influences for me, I would say.
I take from whatever I want. In other words, I think I'm very postmodern maybe in that way. I just take whatever I want. But pop art I love. So possibly that influenced me, but after pop art, I do just whatever I want, whatever enters my head. That's what I'll do, truly.
I studied philosophy and never studied animation. I don't know how to draw, and I just draw the way I can, the best I can. And I would say that the influences is philosophy influenced me, and whatever I was reading, and then also Eastern European poster art, which is amazing. You know, it's very surreal and has a lot of layers on the meaning that I love to just look at the posters and just discover meaning over and over again. And then from the animator Schwankmeyer. And also Bill Plimpton, who taught me how to make films cheap and fast and not to be afraid of humor. So that's my influence.
Also graphic novels. I love graphic novels like Linda Barry. I mean, there's so many of them that inspired me.
Okay, one more question. Yes.
You actually just mentioned graphic novels, and that sort of ties to my question. Mm-hmm. What was it that made you all choose a medium of the image?
Okay.
Like comics?
Yeah. My wife, who I collaborate with, has a theater background, and I have a painting background, and I ran out of space to make paintings back in the 90s, early 90s, so I began doing graphic novels, and I traveled quite a bit, and it was really, really convenient, but the problem with graphic novels is I got a good label, but I literally sold like 80 copies, and it was like Fantagraphics books, and it was really frustrating. I made no money. Well, I actually sold them, but I made like 80 bucks, that's what it was. It was just awful, and I just got sick and tired of like making shit that no one sees. And then my wife, we had the same problem. She had off Broadway shows where, you know, seven of her friends would come, and it was just like a nightmare. And so we decided at some point that we would collaborate and just start making films. And a natural thing to do was animation because it was cheap and we were scrappy and it was fun to do. Yeah.
I would say For I mean, there's some animators who are really, whose work is really close to graphic novels, but I think for a lot of us, we really love movement, and I really love metamorphosis, which is something you can suggest with a series of pictures, but you can't really make it happen. And for me, that's where the magic is.
I'll say it's time-based art, and that's probably the way my mind works. The still image obviously isn't time-based. It tells its story just all at once. And with time-based art, the definition, obviously, it's over a period of time. And that's how my mind works. So.
I don't know the answer.
On that note, let's see what you guys do know. So, well, first of all, I want to thank the panelists. I want to thank Ruth Linkford, Andy London, Jack Feltine, Signe Bauman. All right, guys, thank you so much, and thank you guys for coming.